Abu Ayyub al-Ansari. The minute you hear the name Al-Ansari, you should know that that refers to those of Madinah Munawwara who looked after the Muhajirin who came from Mecca. So Al-Ansar were the helpers. They come from Madinah Munawwara. When you hear Abu Ayyub Al-Ansari, it is the name of the one who hosted Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he came into Madinah Munawwara. So as soon as we hear the name, we should know that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he arrived in Madinah Munawwara, stayed at this man's house. Subhanallah. So Abu Ayyub Al-Ansari, his name was Khalid ibn Zayd. A brother asked me a question earlier that why did they have different names? The truth is, they were called by the names of either their children or something important in their lives, some unique feature. So sometimes, for example, you have a person who had a son. If the son was called Umar, the man is known as Abu Umar. So in this case, Abu Ayyub al-Ansari radiyallahu anhu, his name was Khalid ibn Zayd al-Ansari from the tribe of Khazraj. And he was a man who accepted Islam just before hijra. There was the second pledge in Aqaba during the Hajj, the year before hijra. And that was when approximately 73 men from Madinah Munawwara, including and two females, so making them 75 in total, had met with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam during the season of Hajj. At that time, they used to engage in Hajj, but they considered it a time of business deals and they used to worship their idols and so on, although they also used to go to Mina and they also used to go to the Blessed Lands. But they had changed what they were doing there into a business deal and at the same time just merrymaking, enjoying, feasting, and perhaps worshipping their idols and so on. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam met them at night. And he met them during the days of Tashriq in Mina. And he presented Islam to them. They had come specially to meet him. And Abu Ayyub al-Ansari was one of those. And he had accepted Islam. A few months later, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made the hijrah. Because this meeting was in Dhul Hijjah. And these companions already started the hijrah as the year had changed, but Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam followed through 3 months later. In the month of Rabi' al-Awwal, he arrived in Madinah Munawwara. So initially he arrived in Quba. He spent a few days there. He built the masjid. Allah speaks of Masjid Quba, the first masjid that was built. Allah praises it and says that was a masjid that was built upon piety. The first masjid in Islam, Masjid Quba. Allah says it is better for you to stand in that masjid than in the other masjid that the people had made just nearby with the wrong intentions. So after that, after the few days, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam jumped onto his camel with his belongings and proceeded towards Al-Madinah Al-Munawwara, which is not very far. And the people of Medina, the Ansar, were so excited and delighted. Each one wants Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam to stay with him. So the one comes out and says, "Oh Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, this is my house." And the other one says, "Oh Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, here's my house. I'd like you to be with me. Stay with us. You can stay for as long as you want. We will provide. We will give. What an honor." But Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the problem was sorted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He looked at them and he says, "This camel of mine has been instructed to stop at a certain place. So leave it and let it move until it stops on its own and settles down." According to one narration, "Leave this camel of mine. It is instructed where exactly to sit." So what happened is Abu Ayyub al-Ansari was one of those who was also willing for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam to come to his place. The camel went around and each time it comes close to people, they were getting excited. And each time it passes, they became sad because they knew now it's passed. Until it came to Abu Ayyub al-Ansari radiyallahu anhu's house and the little small space that he had in front of his house, and it sat down there. Subhanallah. How was the excitement? You can imagine. It sat down there. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam got off. He asked whose land it was. The small piece of land belonged to two orphans from Bani Najjar. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam purchased the piece of land and began to build a masjid there. And he stayed in the closest house, which was the house of Abu Ayyub al-Ansari. And there is a very interesting story about this powerful companion who was so lucky to have Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam stay with him for a number of days. Some narrations take it to a few months. But in actual fact, We don't know the exact number of days, but it was until the masjid was built and the houses or the rooms of the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, may Allah be pleased upon all of them, were actually built. That is when he shifted. And when we say built, not like today where it takes 6 months to build something because of how we do it. There, it took a few days. They actually, you know, cleaned the land, dug a small foundation, put up whatever they could, and a lot of it was actually with the palm branches and a little bit of the stumps of the palm and so on. It was not with brick and what we see today. So Abu Ayyub al-Ansari radiallahu anhu, he was so happy, he thanked Allah. He helped Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam with his belongings, and they were very few. And he says, it was like I was carrying the treasures of the whole world in my hand when I walked into my house, so excited with the belongings of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that fitted in my two hands. Imagine, if we have to shift even now from one room to another, wherever we are, we have to get help. Someone has to help me with my bags and my belongings and what have you. This was Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, afdalul khalqi wa akramul rusul, the most blessed of all creation, the highest in rank of all, even the messengers, the highest in rank. And this is what he had, very, very little. So Abu Ayyub al-Ansari, he says to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, my house has two stories. I'd like you to stay at the top because I wouldn't like you to be beneath me. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, no, it is more convenient for me to be at the bottom. There will be so many people coming to see me and meet me, and every time they come to the top, it's not going to be convenient. It's better for you to actually be at the top. So he obeyed the instruction of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, although in his heart he still felt something. And so at night, when he got up, him and his wife, to the top, they served Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam through the day. When he got up to the top, he looked at his wife and she looked at him. Something was wrong. What did we do? How can we be on top of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? It is wrong for us to be walking on top when he is underneath. So they couldn't sleep. And they avoided the center of that floor. When we say floor, it was just a small space that was on the higher level, not what we have today. They avoided the center. They actually walked on the sides and they slept right on the side, but they did not manage to close their eyes. In the morning, they got up very early back to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Abu Ayyub al-Ansari radiallahu anhu goes and says, we could not sleep, O Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because we having you beneath us, how dare, we are so sorry for having done this, you must go up. So Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam again refused and again explained that, look, you know, it is more convenient for me to be at the bottom. Until when it came to the following day, they were at the top and some utensil broke with some water in it. And they were so worried because that time, you know, it was not concrete as we have today. If some liquid had to drop, it would go through the leaves and it would drip on the person who was at the bottom. So they were so worried, they quickly tried to wipe it up, although they did not have pieces of cloth there because they were not so wealthy and so on. And in the morning, they went to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and explained, look, we're finding it difficult. We cannot be up when you are down. And that is when Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam agreed and he went up to the top floor. Subhanallah. This was the relationship they had. Beautiful, the respect they had of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Today, sadly, we say we love Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and we say we respect him and we become passionate and we become people who really, you know, get excited about the statement. But whether we actually follow his example or not is something that is far away. May Allah protect us. May he make us people who are not hypocritical, who only utter with their tongues what they do not really prove with their actions. My brothers and sisters, it's about time we showed the love with our actions as well. And this is why today, when someone tells you, I love you, believe me, 9 times out of 10, they could be telling a lie, especially if it's online or on your phone. It's so simple to say, I love you. To Abu Ayyub al-Ansari radiallahu anhu and his wife, they looked after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And after that, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to his rooms, which were adjacent to the messenger sallallahu alayhi, to the masjid of the messenger, meaning al-masjid al-Nabawi, which was quite a small masjid at the time. And Abu Ayyub al-Ansari was his neighbor radiallahu anhu. My brothers and sisters, here is Abu Ayyub al-Ansari. He says, one day Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came with Abu Bakr and Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhuma to my house, and it was not the time of food, but when I heard their voice at the door, I quickly rushed. I was at the back looking after some of my date palms, And I rushed and they said, we've come to have a meal. So he looked at Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He says, this is not your normal time, but please let me take this branch of dates. Now, there were three types of dates on the branch. One was the dry date, one was the ripe date, and one was the raw date. All these three have a speciality. So Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam looked and he was amazed that these three types of dates have come forth. He says, oh Abu Ayyub, had you only given us the dry, it would have been enough. He said, no, I wanted to give you all the different types of date for you, oh Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He looked at his wife. He says, oh my wife, you know how to bake. I want you to make me fresh bread. And then he went back and he slaughtered one of the small animals he had. He cut it and he actually roasted it whilst they were waiting. In no time, he brought it forth. So there was three types of dates. There was hot bread and there was freshly cut and roasted lamb. Subhanallah. So Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam looks at it and he thanked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, oh Abu Ayyub, I asked you to take a little bit of this for my daughter Fatima. She hasn't had this type of food in a while. I want to stop there. The story carries on, but I want to stop there. How many of us, when we're having a good meal, do we think of our families when they're not there? I think we do. It would be a sign of closeness to your family. You're eating something nice, you say, I wish my wife could taste this. Subhanallah. Don't just say, taste this. Say, I wish you could have this. Subhanallah. I wish my daughter could taste this. Or, I wish they could have. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you sent it for his daughter. So it would be a sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam where you've tasted something nice, take a little bit for your family as well, or get it sent there. It is not only good for you and your family as in your relationship, but it shows people that the families we need to be concerned about. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. Let's go back to the story. So he sent some, then he says, oh my companions, he's now talking to the three of them, and he says, wallahi, with tears in his eyes, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, Allah says in the Quran, indeed you will definitely be asked and questioned and cross-questioned about the gifts that we have bestowed upon you. This is one of the questions we are going to be asked about. The food we've had, how we ate, what we did, how we cooked, how much we ate, who we gave, what happened, where we got it from, and how it was consumed. Subhanallah. So he says, if you would like to know the supplication to be supplicated when you are eating, when you commence, you should say Bismillah. Bismillah meaning in the name of Allah. And when you complete your food, you should say Alhamdulillahi alladhi huwa ashba'ana wa arwana wa an'ama alayna fa afdala. Which means I praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has filled us. Meaning we are no longer hungry, who has filled us and he has quenched our thirst and he has granted us so much gifts and he gave us from the best of it and he has bestowed us with his virtue. This is one of the du'as that can be read when a person has just finished eating and drinking. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst those who are thankful to him, not only in the du'a, but even in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam looked at Abu Ayyub al-Ansari and says, I want to give you something. I want to see you tomorrow. Please come and see me. So Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu noticed that Abu Ayyub al-Ansari radiallahu anhu did not hear. So he says, oh Abu Ayyub, listen to what Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says. He says, come back tomorrow. So the following day, Abu Ayyub al-Ansari radiallahu anhu went to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave him a gift of a small or a young slave girl, and told him, this is a gift for you. She has been such a good slave girl, so kind. She works very dedicated. Look after her and be kind to her. So he thanked Allah. He thanked the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he took this slave girl home. So his wife says, who is this girl? So he explains from Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he told me to be kind to her. So she says, and how are you going to be kind to her? So he says, I will free her so she will no longer be a slave. So the wife says, Subhanallah, you are indeed a blessed man. And this is indeed the best way, the correct way to do things. So he freed her, Subhanallah. And this is something that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was expecting to have been done from Abu Ayyub al-Ansari radiallahu anhu. Now something I must mention about this great man, Abu Ayyub al-Ansari. When Aisha radiallahu anha was accused of adultery by some of the hypocrites, His wife told him, "Oh, Abu Ayyub, did you hear what the people are saying?" He said, "Oh, keep quiet, do not mess your tongue. Do you think you would do such a thing, oh my beloved wife?" She said, "No, I would never do such a thing." So he looked at her and he says, "Well then, Aisha is far better than you, radiallahu anha. She would never ever do such a thing." So Allah revealed verses praising Abu Ayyub al-Ansari. And the verses are, Surah An-Nur, Allah says, "Had the believers not said to themselves when they heard this, that we will not be able to do this ourselves, so Aisha is indeed better than us." And they said immediately, "This is a fabrication and a lie. Do not spoil your tongue with this." May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect our tongues from being spoilt, accusing those who are close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is one of the virtues of Abu Ayyub al-Ansari, radiyallahu anhu. He passed away in Constantinople, or when they went for the conquest of Constantinople, he was one of them. And he remembered a hadith of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam saying, "The first to conquer Constantinople, or the first army to go there to try, shall be forgiven." So on his deathbed, some of the leaders came to him and he said, "Please take me with you until we get to the wall around Constantinople and bury me there." So that's exactly what they did. And today his grave is in Turkey. What we would say, Turkey, subhanallah, this companion of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but his grave is somewhere in Istanbul. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness and ease. There is actually a masjid there, and it is named after him, Sultan Ayyub Mosque. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness and forgiveness. He passed away approximately 52 or 54 Hijri, and he was between 80 and 90 years old, according to the bulk of the narrations. This was Abu Ayyub al-Ansari, radiyallahu anhu.